but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage, and then is heard no more. To die, to sleep. To sleep, perchance to dream. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come. But that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose bourn no traveller returns, puzzles the will and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of. The last, final frontier. Since early days, humankind is not only trying to find answers to the reason of its existence, but also to the unknown final frontier, life after death. Humankind cannot live forever, and when we die, what will we find beyond the grave? Stone Age people, ancient Egyptians, Greeks and Romans were fascinated by life after death. Philosophers, poets, and playwrights have all expounded their theories. Artists give their own impression of life after death. In keeping with traditional views, John Milton's Paradise Lost and William Blake's Marriage of Heaven and Hell are two prominent literary classics that also influence society's attitudes and views regarding the afterlife. Arguably the most influential work, though, was Dante Alighieri's Divine Comedy, the three-part poetry epic which journeyed through Inferno, Purgatorio and Paradiso, or Hell, Purgatory and Heaven. Towards the end of the 20th century, a phenomenon arose in which people reported near-death experiences, otherwise known as NDEs, in which they encountered some form of afterlife reality. Modern medicine began referring to these occurrences as the Lazarus phenomenon, after the biblical character that was revived by Jesus 4 days after his supposed death. This phenomenon of NDEs, in which revived patients report an extension of consciousness beyond clinical death, has been documented for centuries.
Cool my tongue. I am in agony in this fire.
Shafts of radiance came out from the central core. It was like a white fire. Phenomenal radiance in the central core. From that, I watched this brilliant light piercing out. And I thought, even the stars in the universe, even the constellations, must find their energy source from this focal point. What is that light? words appeared in front of my eyes. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. I wonder if I could just see his face. I'll know who God is. As I got within a few feet of his presence, I began to place my face into the light.
And then, as I'm going down into this, I begin to look into the flames, and I begin to see people. I mean, there's thousands. There's too many. I don't know how many people are in the flames, and they're screaming, and their arms are flailing, and their bodies are rolling, and they're burning all over. They're burning like in liquid fire.
But what exactly is an NDE experience, medically speaking? As the name NDE implies, these people have some event in which they are severely physically compromised. Generally, there's a severe physical malady that occurs suddenly or at the end of a chronic illness. NDEs are often associated with cessation of heart function and cessation of breathing function, or very often, both. As a consequence of that, within 10 seconds following cessation of heart function, blood stops flowing in the brain, and the EEG, which measures the electrical brain activity, goes flat, implying that there is no electrical activity in the brain. Given that when you stop breathing and your heart stops, and given that 10 seconds after that, that the EEG, the measure of electrical brain activity, goes absolutely flat, it's medically inexplicable that near-death experiencers are having a conscious experience. For years, however, some medical researchers had dismissed the NDE phenomenon as hallucinations caused by the dying body releasing a chemical cocktail as a means of defense against the pain and shock of impending death. That theory was dented in 1984 by an extraordinary medical emergency in the American West Coast city of Seattle. Maria, a migrant worker from Eastern Europe, was rushed to hospital after she collapsed at a friend's home. In the ICU, a medical team tried to stabilize her condition without success. Her heart stopped beating. Maria's body was lifeless for several minutes, but the doctors kept on trying to bring her back to life. Then they suddenly realized that the heart monitor showed some life. Maria was supposed to be dead. Maria came back to life and immediately told an amazing story. She saw everything while she left her body. She could see the medical team working on her. She then left the ICU to the roof of the hospital, and as she went up, saw a tennis shoe. No one believed her story, but her friends immediately ran up to the roof and with absolute shock found the tennis shoe exactly as described by Maria. Maria's experience could not be anything other than the absolute truth. If the out-of-body experience was purely a mental aberration, how could she have seen a physical reality that could later be verified? After Maria's revelation, other similar stories began to emerge of NDE patients undergoing out-of-body experiences and being able to relate verifiable details that they could not have imagined. Can we still say NDEs are hallucinations?
I think in terms of, in terms of the consistency of the testimonies in near-death experiences, it suggests that the experience is a reality which is not purely the product of brain chemicals, because, I mean, we know from studies of the effects of drugs ordinarily that if you give one person a drug and then give the same drug to another person, they'll have two completely different experiences. There might be broad similarities, but not the level of consistency you find with a near-death experience.
No, there's no person can dispute whether these experiences are the normal functioning of the brain at the point of death, or rather represent some sort of chaotic hallucinatory activity. Remember, hallucinations involve the perception of something that isn't real. So when we die, we're alert, we're conscious, we're aware of this reality. So certainly people having near-death experiences accurately describe what's happening in this reality. But the key element of the near-death experience is that we perceive, I say we, as all of us are going to have this experience, we perceive another reality superimposed over this one.
If NDEs are not hallucinations, is heaven and hellish experience reality?
I think in terms of whether the places visited in near-death experiences, either heavenly or in terms of a hellish type experience, are real, is something that's beyond proof. Ultimately, one would have to die in order to determine whether there was a genuine heaven or a genuine hell. But what's very clear from a psychological perspective is that the intensity of the experience is lived as real whilst the person's having it. So for these people, whether or not there really ends up actually being a heaven or a hell, they feel the experience is real for them at that moment in time. There's certainly no way we can deduce or prove that if someone sees an afterlife and it's heavenly, that heaven exists, because you'd have to die in order to really truly find that out.
When we die, we take that heaven and hell with us, and we fit where we belong. We live, we die the life we live. Near-death experiences don't make a sinner into a saint, necessarily, but doesn't change much, but you become more aware. And a serial killer, when they die, would become more aware of how much of a, and punishment they inflicted on others.
Yeah.
And that's that condition.
The question then arises, can there then be such a thing as an objective heaven or hell? Or are these places merely the product of religious superstition? Is there actual scientific evidence to support their existence? Today's scholars and religious figures are certainly divided. Some talk of reincarnation, others of assimilation into the universal life force. Nobody knows for sure.
I'm a pastor.
Or do they?
I stole money from the church and I lied. Help me!
Different cultures and religions experience NDEs differently. Even people of the same religion interpret NDEs differently. The question is, do the Muslim or Christian heaven and hell, for example, appear differently when experiencing an NDE? Reports of these so-called hellish or negative near-death experiences that closely resemble biblical imagery have sparked global interest in the ongoing debate to such an extent that research is currently being conducted by both the academic and scientific mainstream. Certainly the debate has been going on for centuries. Some claim hell is a human invention. Today, it's not just the scientific community that is evaluating the preconceptions of a heaven and hell, but also religious institutions. Some churches even go so far as to say that there isn't a hell, and question whether these archaic beliefs are still valid in the 21st century. But how do these hellish experiences appear?
When we die, we go through a fairly rigorous series of events. And a picture that a child drew of nearly drowning, I think, illustrates this better than anything else. And we can see in this picture, the first thing he draws when he nearly drowned is he states that hands reached inside his body and pulled him out. Doesn't identify who these hands belong to. But then these hands plunged him into darkness.
As I'm standing there, I become acutely aware that the darkness isn't just physical, but there is a spiritual component to it. An evil, cold, encroaching. It's like the atmosphere is permeated with a cold sensation, a chill or a terror.
Visible eyes of something or someone checking me out. The darkness had it in the atmosphere.
What?
Now shut up.
As I stood there, realizing I could actually be in hell.
Then I felt my body begin to move. I was strapped to a gurney, but it was like my body began to float. And I'm floating through this smoke. And I'm going faster and faster. And I can't understand what's going on. And I begin to hear voices all around in the smoke. And the voices are crying. The voices are screaming. And there's all kinds of groaning. And then it's like I'm coming out of this smoke, like I'm coming out of a tunnel. And I'm looking down into what appeared to be the open mouth of a volcanic crater, like a burning lake. And I'm falling into this. I'm just going down into this, and I have no control. And the smell is awful, and I can't breathe, and my ears are full of these screams. And then, as I'm going down into this, I begin to look into the flames, and I begin to see people. I mean, there's thousands. There's too many. I don't know how many people are in the flames. And they're screaming, and their arms are flailing, and their bodies are rolling, and they're burning all over. They're burning like in liquid fire. But they're not burning up. They're just burning. And like a close-up lens on a camera, some of those faces loomed up in front of me. Their faces are screaming, contorted, and they're calling my name. Ronnie, Ronnie, don't come here. There's no escape.
Hell seems to be a terrible place. Nothing that we will encounter in this world. But what do researchers say? Dr. Tony Lawrence from the University of Coventry.
From my position in terms of transpersonal psychology, the psychology of spirituality, which would deal directly with notions of evil and of good, and of hell and of heaven. My perspective on what hell would be is that hell is not a place that you go to as such. Hell is more a conditional state of mind that a person has when they're ignorant of the possibilities in their life, the possibilities for love and joy and happiness, and of leading a meaningful life, so that in fact anyone at any one moment in time, by virtue of just being ignorant of their circumstances and of themselves and their place in the world, would literally be in hell. But it wouldn't be, it's not a place that you can go to. It's a state of being, for me personally. Yeah.
We don't know what happens after we die. For sure, there's no objectively, hell isn't a planet on the other side of Jupiter that we haven't discovered yet. This is clearly a mental phenomena that happens to us when we die. It's real. The calculus is real. Mathematics is real. Love is real. These experiences are real experiences, but they're dynamic experiences. They happen to us when we die. So I think the best way to understand the hellish experience is that we pass through hell as part of the dying process, if that hell is based on what our lives were like. If we're isolated, if we're alone, if we harm others, if we have religious belief systems which incorporate an objectively real hell, if we're afraid of the dark and we don't understand that darkness is part of the dying experience, all of those things woven together, or any of them individually, will then contribute to having a hellish near-death experience.
Is the experience then purely subjective? Some experts believe not. Dr. Richard Kent, a retired medical doctor, has traveled the world studying the NDE phenomenon over many years and has written several books on the subject. Of the 300 case studies he has made, an alarming amount report not only the existence of a heavenly afterlife reality, but also a hellish one.
A place called hell. And they describe it's an absolutely terrible and awful place. Now, I don't know what it's like in South Africa, but in England, many churches don't talk about hell very much. I don't know why. Jesus spoke about hell a great deal. He said it's a place to be avoided. Anyway, they describe hell as somewhere that's dark and oppressive. They also were told in the scriptures where it is. It's in the center of the earth. Now, people say, well, where do you get that from? Well, it's in the scriptures. Matthew 12 is verses 40 and 41, I believe. Jesus says, I'll give you the sign of Jonah. Just as Jonah was in the belly of a great fish for 3 days and for three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and for three nights. Now, Jesus talked about hell, or the place of the departed spirits at the time of Jesus, being in the heart of the earth. All right? So it's somewhere in the heart of this planet, I believe. Now, for example, in the Old Testament, the spirit of Samuel came up from Sheol, the Old Testament hell, and the sons of Korah went down to Sheol, the Old Testament hell. We're told in the book of Ephesians that one day every knee will bow, those above the earth, those on the earth, and those under the earth. So I believe it's somewhere down there. Now, they describe it as very hot, it's very unpleasant, there are demons there who are tormenting the people who go there. It says in the scriptures that Lazarus was in torment. It's just a horrendous, awful place. It's a place where people are terrified, are frightened, and people even who've seen hell, even years later, they recall in horror of what they saw there. Just a place of awfulness. People have seen Satan there. People have actually had conversations with Satan. People have had conversations with demons there. People have heard the demons swear. They said they never heard language such as they heard in hell. They heard all the swear words that are commonly used and more.
Was assigned to an assembly belt under penalty of judgment by some helper, evil over here, if he didn't complete placing these giant multicolored puzzles, like a jigsaw puzzle that was coming by, one piece to the next. If he didn't get it on time, he was under penalty. And he was screaming, I'm in hell. Where's the hell? To him, that was hell. He never wants that again. Never. He converted his whole life. He converted his wife, too, who he woke in that hospital in Knoxville with his head in her lap in the hospital bed. It was a very touching story. And this. It's life-changing. Everything is so violently life-changing, so peacefully life-changing, so wonderful. So you're onto a subject that is important to every individual present. Is it safe to die? Do I know where I'm going before I get there? That's the question.
And what of heaven? Is it the blinding white light, the benevolent presence of a supreme being, the wondrous feeling of love and peace that we've always imagined it to be? Some NDE survivors also got to glimpse heaven and found it just as real and tangible as hell had been.
As I was drawn into the opening, I could now see that it was a tunnel. As I looked along the length of it, I could see the source of the radiance. My first thought is the center of the universe. Look at the light. Look at the power coming from there. As I've been moved towards it, I watch as a wave of radiance comes up. As this wave of light comes off the source, it touches me and I feel warmth, comfort. All that kind of fear and darkness just seems to go out of me and I feel a living light flow through me. Shafts of radiance came out from the central core. It was like a white fire. Phenomenal radiance in the central core. From that, I watched this brilliant light piercing out. And I thought, even the stars in the universe, even the constellations must find their energy source from this focal point. What is that light? Is there someone in there surrounded by this radiance? As I questioned that in my own mind, a voice spoke to me from the center of the light.
Right, for sure. Well, first of all, their spirit leaves their bodies. And then very commonly, they meet Jesus Christ. They describe him as nearly 6 foot tall, but radiating light, tremendous amount of light coming from him, from his face and from his chest and from his arms and from his legs. Many people describe he's still dressed in the clothes appropriate to a Jewish rabbi, because Jesus was a Jewish rabbi, and he has a golden sash around his waist. Many people, as they come close to, in their minds come these words, "You're in the presence of the Son of God." At that point, many people get down and start to worship Jesus Christ. And at that point, they realize he's still got holes in his hands and in his feet, because they're quite close to his feet by then. And they realize that those crucifixion holes are still there. But people, isn't just the appearance of Jesus. It's the fact that they feel in the presence of so much love. Many people said they've never felt like that. They've never felt so completely surrounded by love, as powerful as that. It's just incredible love. I mean, for example, some of the people I've interviewed have been hardened Second World War soldiers. I mean, these are, you know, tough guys. And they started to cry as they described coming to the presence of Jesus. Amazing, really. And then, of course, after that, people either go to heaven, not invariably, but many, either go to heaven or go to hell. Now, let's talk about the nice place. In heaven, first of all, they find themselves in their spirit bodies. They're looking down and they're looking at bright white hands and bright white feet. In fact, the whole body is bright and light and white. They're different bodies. They feel young, they feel rejuvenated, they feel fully in control of all their senses. And yet, for example, Dr. Eby, he described, he said that his sort of reasoning power was greatly increased. His thought processes were much more powerful. He could see much, much further. He could hear much more. His hearing was much more powerful. His whole body was just a much better upgrade model, if you like. But then what do they see? Well, first of all, they often describe walking either on streets of transparent gold, as it says in Revelation 21, or walking in fields of flowers, but these flowers are radiating light. Light comes from the trees and the flowers and the grass. And there's not only light coming from the trees and the flowers and the grass, but music as well. And here's an amazing thing. Many, many people have said, "Richard, an extraordinary thing, but you can see music in heaven." Now, I can't explain that. I just can't explain that, but they say you can see the music in heaven. And then they say there's no sun there, but light just comes from the trees and the flowers and the grass. People have seen the river of life. Some people have seen the throne of God, that's called the Father, which is very big, actually. It's many people said it's up to 3 stories high. And there's a rainbow over the throne, just like it says in the scriptures. Many people have seen this great lake in front of the throne, and people have seen crowds and crowds of people around the throne of God, all praising God. And remember, you can see the music. Now, people have been transported around different parts of heaven. We tend to think of heaven as a place. It's a huge, huge place. It's huge, it's massive. It's outside time, which is difficult for us to comprehend. But another thing is people can travel to different parts of heaven instantaneously. People looked up to mountains and said, "You know, I'd like to be there," and they would instantly be there. People have met their angels, their personal angels. Psalm 91 says we have our own personal angels, and many, many people have seen their own personal angels. It's amazing, it's absolutely, one woman I'm thinking of met her own child in heaven. This little girl, she was only 10, she was killed by a truck or a lorry. This was in the States. And when she got to heaven, there's this little child playing in a beautiful garden. And she was ecstatically happy playing with a lot of other children as well. And in fact, this particular lady said to the little girl, "Wouldn't you like to come back to earth?" And she said, "Well, Jesus said I could. But actually, it was such fun here, I decided to stay here." So there we are. So that's heaven. Heaven is just dramatic. In fact, you can always tell when people have been to heaven because they're just yearning to go back. Most of the people who I've met who've really seen heaven just wanted to be there.
It is clear that adults who experience NDEs are influenced by their religious and cultural value system. But what about those who are not yet influenced by culture or religion? Young children. Will they give us a better view on NDE?
So it's then a matter of religious belief systems as to whether you think that other reality is real or not. So that's the issue of religion and philosophy. But nevertheless, when I say near-death experiences are real, I mean that they occur when these children say that they're happening, which means at the point of death. Let me give you an example. I resuscitated a young boy about 8 years old who had a massive cardiac failure in the lobby of Seattle Children's Hospital. Dramatic resuscitation. After we successfully brought him back to life, he opened his eyes and he goes, "That was weird. You guys just sucked me back into my body." He accurately described everything that was happening to him. He could see the top of one of our attending physicians' heads who was starting to go bald and accurately described that, even though we knew at this time he was comatose. In addition, he said that while he was being resuscitated and his heart had stopped, he was on the ceiling looking down at us and he was bathed in a white light. A white light that he thought was something trying to keep him safe. So what if that experience could be a hallucination? Well, clearly he accurately described what happened to him, so that part wasn't a hallucination. But you could say the hallucinatory elements then were this white light. Is that white light real or not? I don't know.
Before we can understand this strange phenomenon, we have to understand the nature of the near-death experience itself.
When we die, we go through a fairly rigorous series of events. And a picture that a child drew of nearly drowning, I think, illustrates this better than anything else. And we can see in this picture, the first thing he draws when he nearly drowned is he states that hands reached inside his body and pulled him out. Doesn't identify who these hands belong to. But then these hands plunged him into darkness. And it's clear that this darkness that's part of the near-death experience is the darkness that's the absence of sensation and input from our body. So the hallmark of the dying experience is that we're conscious and awake while we're dying. But we're not receiving input anymore from our eyes or our ears or our proprioceptive, our touch senses, or any of those kinds of senses. So of course we perceive darkness. So the first stage of the dying experience is to have the perception of darkness.
I suddenly found myself in a standing upright position, wide awake. I knew I was awake. The trouble was, it was pitch black. And my first thought was, why on earth those doctors can't turn the lights out in here? What kind of hospital is this? As I stood there, wondering how long I'd been asleep for and why the lights were out, I thought, well, don't freak out. Let your eyes accustomed to the dark. Maybe you've woken up too quick. So I kept looking, thinking my pupils had dilated. No light. Couldn't see a thing. It was pitch black, like a dark room. So, well, okay. There must be some light in here somewhere. So I turned around 360 degrees, checking out to see if there's some light. Couldn't see a thing. As I went out to my right, I couldn't find the wall. I thought, that's weird. Have they moved me? So I started moving back to the left, groping around looking for my beard. Couldn't find it. I thought, great, you idiot, now you've lost your beard. How on earth did you do that? So as I'm groping around physically trying to find my beard, the next thought that comes into my mind is that it's so dark in here, you can't seem to see your hand in front of your face. So I brought my hand up to where my face should be, and it seemed to pass straight through, as if there was no physical form there. I thought, that's impossible. You can't miss your head. I went for my physical body, absolutely nothing. I thought, what the hell?
heck's going on? It's like I'm out of my physical form. It's like I'm transparent, yet I have the sensation of being a total human being standing here. Ian, who I am, appears to be standing here. What's happened?
The experience is vividly real. It's just as real as this experience right now. It doesn't have any hallucinatory or dreamlike qualities. So this darkness is extremely scary. And you can see in this picture here that after this young artist draws us darkness, we see the darkness then start to evolve into a what he calls a light, and then ultimately what he thinks is heaven, which for this young Boy Scout is a pup tent in a golden field. So the elements of the experience involve the cessation of input from this reality, the perception of darkness, since we're still conscious, and then the perception of yet another reality. And that reality is primarily based on our own perceptions of what happens when we die. So we die the life we live.
According to the facts, NDE is a phenomenon which exists. It is not hallucinations, but a real, inexplicable conscious experience. But what have academics to say who researched this mysterious phenomenon?
I mean, there are broadly three perspectives on the near-death experience. You've got skeptical explanations, which usually argue that the near-death experience is some kind of brain abnormality near death, or some chemical abnormality in the brain near death. And then you've got parapsychological explanations, which argue that the near-death experience might not be a genuine glimpse of a heaven, but nevertheless contains some paranormal components, say, for example, extrasensory perception. And then you've got psychological explanations of the near-death experience, which argue that it's some kind of motivated fantasy, that someone perceiving themselves to be near death becomes very afraid and constructs out of fantasy in their own mind a heavenly realm to which they go. The problem with that final explanation is it doesn't account for negative experiences. Why would people who were fearful of death be motivated to fantasize about hell? That's counterproductive. So I think psychological explanations are the poorest explanations of the near-death experience. It's either going to boil down to there's genuinely a heaven or a hell, or brain chemicals are causing the experience.
Near-death experiences are the last experience that any of us will have while we're still alive. They're misnamed. They're not the near-death experiences at all, but they're the dying experience. This isn't a belief that I have. This, to me, is a scientific fact that has been documented now by 15 years of mainstream scientific research. What we've learned in the last 15 years is in the process of dying, several astonishing and counterintuitive things happen. Namely, the dying person has a complete return to consciousness. They're alert and aware of what's going on around them, even if they seem to be comatose. And they have an expanded sense of consciousness that extends beyond their body. How do we know this isn't just a dream or a weird hallucination? Dreams happen to people who are sleeping at night and are associated with certain brainwave activity. So clearly it's absurd to think near-death experiences would be a dream. What about being hallucinations? Chaotic dysfunctioning of the dying brain? Absolutely. They could be that. No, there's no person can dispute whether these experiences are the normal functioning of the brain at the point of death, or rather represent some sort of chaotic hallucinatory activity. Remember, hallucinations involve the perception of something that isn't real. So when we die, we're alert, we're conscious, we're aware of this reality, so certainly people having near-death experiences accurately describe what's happening in this reality. But the key element of the near-death experience is that we perceive, I say we, as all of us are going to have this experience, we perceive another reality superimposed over this one. So it's then a matter of religious belief systems as to whether you think that other reality is real or not. So that's the issue of religion and philosophy, but nevertheless, when I say near-death experiences are real, I mean that they occur when these children say that they're happening, which means at the point of death.
One group that understands NDE all too well is IONS, otherwise known as the International Association for Near-Death Studies. Founded in the early 80s, it was established to support the near-death experiencer and encourage NDE research. Today, it has a very large membership in many countries. Other groups have followed suit, and significant advances have been made in numerous groundbreaking studies. One such study tested the validity of out-of-body experiences while under life-saving surgery.
Nevertheless, when I say near-death experiences are real, I mean that they occur when these children say that they're happening, which means at the point of death. Let me give you an example. I resuscitated a young boy about 8 years old who had a massive cardiac failure in the lobby of Seattle Children's Hospital. Dramatic resuscitation. After we successfully brought him back to life, he opened his eyes and he goes, "That was weird. You guys just sucked me back into my body." He accurately described everything that was happening to him. He could see the top of one of our attending physicians' heads, who was starting to go bald, and accurately described that, even though we knew at this time he was comatose. In addition, he said that while he was being resuscitated and his heart had stopped, he was on the ceiling looking down at us, and he was bathed in a white light, a white light that he thought was something trying to keep him safe. So what if that experience could be a hallucination? Well, clearly he accurately described what happened to him, so that part wasn't a hallucination. But you could say the hallucinatory elements then were this white light. Is that white light real or not? I don't know.
Before we can understand this strange phenomenon, we have to understand the nature of the near-death experience itself.
When we die, we go through a fairly rigorous series of events. And a picture that a child drew of nearly drowning, I think, illustrates this better than anything else. And we can see in this picture, the first thing he draws when he nearly drowned is he states that hands reached inside his body and pulled him out. Doesn't identify who these hands belong to. But then these hands plunged him into darkness. And it's clear that this darkness that's part of the near-death experience is the darkness that's the absence of sensation and input from our body. So the hallmark of the dying experience is that we're conscious and awake while we're dying. But we're not receiving input anymore from our eyes or our ears or our proprioceptive, our touch senses, or any of those kinds of senses. So of course we perceive darkness. So the first stage of the dying experience is to have the perception of darkness.
I suddenly found myself in a standing upright position, wide awake. I knew I was awake. The trouble was, it was pitch black. And my first thought was, why on earth are those doctors can't turn the lights out in here? What kind of hospital is this? As I stood there, wondering how long I'd been asleep for and why the lights were out, I thought, well, don't freak out. Let your eyes accustom to the dark. Maybe you've woken up too quick. So I kept looking, thinking my pupils had dilated. No light. Couldn't see a thing. It was pitch black, like a dark room. So, well, okay. There must be some light in here somewhere. So I turned around 360 degrees, checking out to see if there's some light. Couldn't see a thing. As I went out to my right, I couldn't find the wall. I thought, that's weird. Have they moved me? So I started moving back to the left, groping around looking for my beard. Couldn't find it. I thought, great, you idiot, now you've lost your beard. How on earth did you do that? So as I'm groping around physically trying to find my beard, the next thought that comes into my mind is that it's so dark in here, you can't seem to see your hand in front of your face. So I brought my hand up to where my face should be, and it seemed to pass straight through, as if there was no physical form there. I thought, that's impossible. You can't miss your head. I mean, for my physical body, absolutely nothing.
What the heck's going on? It's like I'm out of my physical form. It's like I'm transparent, yet I have the sensation of being a total human being standing here. Ian, who I am, appears to be standing here. What's happened?
The experience is vividly real. It's just as real as this experience right now. It doesn't have any hallucinatory or dreamlike qualities. So this darkness is extremely scary. And you can see in this picture here that after this young artist draws us darkness, we see the darkness then start to evolve into a what he calls a light, and then ultimately what he thinks is heaven, which for this young Boy Scout is a pup tent in a golden field. So the elements of the experience involve the cessation of input from this reality, the perception of darkness, since we're still conscious, and then the perception of yet another reality. And that reality is primarily based on our own perceptions of what happens when we die. So we die the life we live.
According to the facts, NDE is a phenomenon which exists. It is not hallucinations, but a real, inexplicable, conscious experience. But what have academics to say who researched this mysterious phenomenon?
I mean, there are broadly three perspectives on the near-death experience. You've got skeptical explanations, which usually argue that the near-death experience is some kind of brain abnormality near death, or some chemical abnormality in the brain near death. And then you've got parapsychological explanations, which argue that the near-death experience might not be a genuine glimpse of heaven, but nevertheless contains some paranormal components, say, for example, extrasensory perception. And then you've got psychological explanations of the near-death experience, which argue that it's some kind of motivated fantasy, that someone perceiving themselves to be near death becomes very afraid and constructs out of fantasy in their own mind a heavenly realm to which they go. The problem with that final explanation is it doesn't account for negative experiences. Why would people who were fearful of death be motivated to fantasize about hell? That's counterproductive. So I think psychological explanations are the poorest explanations of the near-death experience. It's either going to boil down to there's genuinely a heaven or a hell, or brain chemicals are causing the experience.
Near-death experiences are the last experience that any of us will have while we're still alive. They're misnamed. They're not the near-death experiences at all, but they're the dying experience. This isn't a belief that I have. This, to me, is a scientific fact that has been documented now by 15 years of mainstream scientific research. What we've learned in the last 15 years is in the process of dying, several astonishing and counterintuitive things happen. Namely, the dying person has a complete return to consciousness. They're alert and aware of what's going on around them, even if they seem to be comatose. And they have an expanded sense of consciousness that extends beyond their body. How do we know this isn't just a dream or a weird hallucination? Dreams happen to people who are sleeping at night and are associated with certain brainwave activity. So clearly it's absurd to think near-death experiences would be a dream. What about being hallucinations? Chaotic dysfunctioning of the dying brain? Absolutely. They could be that. No, there's no person can dispute whether these experiences are the normal functioning of the brain at the point of death, or rather represent some sort of chaotic hallucinatory activity. Remember, hallucinations involve the perception of something that isn't real. So when we die, we're alert, we're conscious, we're aware of this reality, so certainly people having near-death experiences accurately describe what's happening in this reality. But the key element of the near-death experience is that we perceive, I say we, as all of us are going to have this experience, we perceive another reality superimposed over this one. So it's then a matter of religious belief systems as to whether you think that other reality is real or not. So that's the issue of religion and philosophy. But nevertheless, when I say near-death experiences are real, I mean that they occur when these children say that they're happening, which means at the point of death.
One group that understands NDE all too well is IONS, otherwise known as the International Association for Near-Death Studies. Founded in the early 80s, it was established to support the near-death experiencer and encourage NDE research. Today, it has a very large membership in many countries. Other groups have followed suit, and significant advances have been made in numerous groundbreaking studies. One such study tested the validity of out-of-body experiences while under life-saving surgery. Surgical patients were split into two groups. The first group claimed to have an out-of-body experience while under anesthetic. The second claimed to have had no out-of-body experience. The two groups were asked to describe what had happened to them while receiving treatment. Those who had experienced no out-of-body sensation made wild guesses and were overwhelmingly wrong. The out-of-body group, by contrast, gave startlingly accurate descriptions of what the surgery or treatment had entailed, including giving precise details of data readouts on the surgery's electrical equipment during the operation. The concept of extended consciousness after clinical death had moved from the realm of religious belief to verifiable scientific fact. There's been a very good study of people that had cardiac arrests or heart attacks. About 15% of them had NDEs, and the remainder did not have NDEs. And then they studied this group of people for up to 7 years. And there's no question that the people that had NDEs were significantly different from the other group. They tended to have a more spiritual belief system. They had a much lower fear of death. They had a much less materialistic view of the world. They were much more interested in religion, and it really changed their lives a great deal. So this has been studied very carefully, or what is called prospective or controlled studies, and has been proven to be fact. The event is so common. The pattern of the experience is so consistent. And its effect on people is so profound that just for that reason alone, even forgetting why or what the spiritual or religious implications are, NDEs are something that affect a lot of people in a major way. Interestingly enough, another study, quite separate from the NDE, has also lent remarkable authenticity to the Lazarus phenomenon. Dr. James Winnery, head of the US Air Force's Aeronautical Research Unit, has come up with some fascinating insights into loss of consciousness. Dr. Winnery works specifically with fighter pilots, exposed to acceleration stress of up to 9 Gs. That's 9 times the gravitational force on Earth. It's his job to put protective measures in place in order to ensure their safety.
Now, one of the things that we began to look at from the science standpoint was in understanding loss of consciousness, especially when blood flow stops to the brain. We began to look at other events that humans go through, like cardiac arrest, sudden death episodes where an individual's heart stops or he has a rhythm disturbance that prevents blood flow from going to the brain. We were looking at what scientists were doing over in those areas. And we began to see that individuals that had sudden death, cardiac arrest, those kind of things, we began to see people reporting the experiences that those people had. And when we began to hear what individuals that had what were called near-death experiences were having these kind of experiences of dreams or being out of body or those kind of things, we really began to look at our information and we said, boy, our folks are having a lot of the same symptoms that are being reported with sudden death and cardiac arrest. So we were really on track of a very hardcore traditional applied research medical program, and it just so happened that the information that we had from loss of conscious episodes was matching fairly closely the information we were getting from the literature in terms of sudden death, cardiac arrest, and near-death experiences. So we thought it would be interesting to the general scientific community to hear what our experiences were in completely healthy people having blood flow stopped to their brain, losing consciousness, returning blood flow, consciousness returning. We thought that would be at least a slice of information that might help individuals that are investigating near-death experiences might be interested in. I think, as a traditional scientist, I think what our experiments really do is really lend tremendous credibility to what individuals that are having near-death experiences are saying. You really need to listen carefully, because our results suggest, incidentally, coming late on the scene, that what these individuals are experiencing are reported very accurately. So I think our experiments really lend a lot of credibility to that. I don't think our experiments give the final answer. I think they give you a lot of insight into probably what's going on in the brain, but boy, and there are things that our experiments don't show. So you have to listen to those individuals that have had even more traumatic insults of embarrassment of blood flow to their brain. They may well be experiencing things that we don't have, but the things that we're seeing certainly lends a lot of credibility to listen to what things they experience that we don't, that may truly give you insight into spiritual and other understandings of life and death and what we're all about.
Research proves that near-death experience is legitimate. Nearly 12 to 15 million Americans have had NDE experiences. This is such an enormous number of shared experiences that so greatly affects their lives that no matter what the cause of NDE, no matter what your ideas about why it occurs, there is no question that given the number of lives that it has impacted, it makes sense to study it. It's an incredible phenomenon. And again, the implications are enormous. But what spiritual importance has NDE to us, who must face the last final frontier one day?
But in terms of spiritual importance, near-death experiences have clear spiritual importance. People often regard themselves as having changed their life entirely as a result of the joyful experiences they have near death. And even in negative near-death experiences, where people have trips that are hellish, people often report life-changing events. And arguably, even if it were brain chemical changes that were responsible for the actual near-death experience, and therefore it's a hallucination, the consequences could still be spiritual for someone.
For mankind, the NDE phenomenon holds a message. Death is reality, and according to research and those who have witnessed heaven and hell through NDE experiences, we must think about our own lives. We will die as we live.
What people are describing are very, very clear-cut, life-changing situations. Now, I think you mentioned you saw Ian McCormack, and when all said and done, he's been travelling around the world for nearly 20 years. And he, like many, many of the others, recalls exactly what he saw, to the very finest detail. And although he has been recounting his experience, and many others have as well, probably two, three, or even four times a week for all these years, you can look at old videotapes, and what they described hasn't changed at all. It simply hasn't changed. And in fact, this event is the single event in their lives that they remember most clearly, unlike hallucinations. The other thing, of course, is that these are life-changing events. I've interviewed probably over 300 people who've had these experiences, and all of them have been dramatically changed. Their lives have been changed by these near-death experiences. You can't say that about hallucinations. Hallucinations simply aren't life-changing experiences, whereas a near-death experience is, when you meet Jesus Christ and either see heaven or hell, they are dramatic, riveting, life-changing experiences, and almost invariably people's lives are dramatically altered as a result of these experiences. So personally, and also because of the fact that the near-death experience accounts are so remarkably similar not only to each other but also to the Bible, I personally believe that these are real events and people are describing real events.
Those people who have had near-death experiences, who have crossed the unknown final frontier, bring a clear message. Heaven and hell is a reality. More and more scientific evidence proves that life after death does exist. Eventually, we will all die and have to cross the final frontier, either to heaven or to hell. But where we are going is a matter of choice.